The next speaker of the day is a renowned gentleman, Mr. Shekhar Gupta, who's going to speak off the cuff. In June 2014, Mr. Shekhar Gupta concluded a 19-year stint at the Indian Express and the Express Group of Publications. As editor-in-chief, he led the country's largest network of award-winning journalists. During a 38-year career, Shekharji has reported on key Indian and international events. Shekhar Guptaji is a chairman and editor-in-chief of The Print, an exciting news media startup. He is a prolific columnist with the highly influential column National Interest, which is translated into various languages. He is a senior primetime anchor at NDTV. Shekharji is the recipient of several awards and honors, including the 1985 INLEX Award for Young Journalist of the Year, G.K. Reddy Award for Journalism, the Fakhruddin Ali Ahmed Memorial Award for National Integration, and he was awarded Padma Bhushan in 2009. Friends, please put your hands together for Padma Bhushan Shri Shekhar Gupta.
Thank you very much. See, those of you, I see the age profile of this group. I think many of you have seen movies in the 60s. Which used to be very sad and serious. So you found Meena Kumari movies. You know, my mother used to say, Meena Kumari ki film dekhne ja rahe ho, do rumal le jao, rona padega. So anytime things got a bit serious between Meena Kumari or Dilip Kumar or Guru Dutt or any of those characters, suddenly, apropos of nothing, arrived Johnny Walker to break the sort of sorrow a little bit. So everybody just laughed, you know, some nonsense like Jaane kaha mera zigar gaya ji. It had no relevance to what was going on. So I am quite realistic. I know that that's my role today. In the morning you've had General Hasnain talk about being up there and, you know, finding passion for the job. And then you had Fahim talking about your business. In fact, I've been a user of printers, but I don't know much about printing. So in fact, when I came in, I saw Mudrika there. It reminded me of my days in school when the most important Mudrika for us used to be not the ring on the finger, but the Mudrika bus service in Delhi. Because you could hop on and off anywhere in Delhi. It used to run around the ring road. And we knew Mudrika's regular stops and also irregular stops. Where somebody, anywhere where Sanjay Gandhi put up a Jhugi Jhopri colony, Mudrika would start stopping. So, I was asking what else is going on today. So after General Hasnain, I'm told Fahim, you're talking about S-curve. So my immediate question to Mehul was, but S has two curves, not one curve. So what S-curve? You know, anyway, I was explained what it is. So I know that you want a little bit of a relief, and that's what I'll try to do. I will also explain to you the twist in the name of the new media startup that I'm setting up. The Print, because everybody tells you print is dead, and don't worry, print is not dead. All of you will do fine. Because print will not just survive, print will prosper. Because remember, India is a very different demographic than the rest of the world. India is not Europe. India is not America. And India is definitely not Japan. India is a country where even now, our population is not growing very fast. It's in fact down to net population growth rate is down to 1.4% per year and will decline further. But still we are adding about 1.5 crore to our population every year. Not just that, we still have about 35 to 40 crore Indians who are illiterate. So every year with our literacy program, nearly 4 crore Indians, that's 40 million Indians are becoming literate. As people become literate, in a very vibrant and very argumentative and very noisy and very politicized democracy like India, so politicized that we can bring an entire state to a standstill, have a special session of the assembly. Why? Because we want to fight with bulls, right? We are so politicized. So in a country like that, the moment people become literate, they start using the media. And when I say the media, it's not just the news media, all media, because they start reading. So what's happening to India is, just when Europe's populations and Europe's consumer bases are declining, the extreme example of this is Japan. In fact, I was in Davos last week, and I met this very interesting minister from Japan, Kozo Yamamoto, with a very interesting designation. I have never seen a designation like that for any minister in the world. It said Minister for Promotion of Reversal of Population Decline. Right? There's actually a minister like that, and he spoke at a session, and I had a conversation with him because declining population is a big problem there. You know, in Japan now, the sale of adult diapers has exceeded the sale of baby diapers, right? It's unlikely to happen in India for a very long time, right? Okay, we are producing fewer and fewer babies, which is a good thing. I mean, if you just want to understand India's population growth, it is today exactly half India's net population growth. We should not always make comparisons with Pakistan because it's the next biggest country to us and very similar in ethnicity population profile. We are growing at 1.4%, which is exactly the half of the growth rate, say, of Pakistan. So as countries become more successful, more prosperous, people acquire more stake, greater stake in life, they produce fewer children, but still we produce enough to keep the printer's business going. And in every area, you know, Fahim, I believe you are a pharma printer. You must be very good at printing fine print, I'm sure. Because all packages have important stuff only in fine print. Terrible side effects, expiry dates, etc., etc., etc. But people will now read everything. Much as we'd like to say that they will read on handheld devices, this will not be all. People trust the printed word. So please don't worry about that. The reason I called our enterprise the print, it's not up yet, it's in the works, is there's a story behind it. Because it is going to be primarily a digital platform, although we will not give up print. And the story goes back to a hall like this, a filled hall like this, in Vigyan Bhavan in Delhi. And this was last year, Sharad Pawar's 75th birthday celebrations. When Sharad Pawar collected all and sundry of Indian politics, there was Narendra Modi, there was Pranab Mukherjee, there was Sonia Gandhi, Sitaram Yechuri, Mulayam Singh Yadav, every leader, the entire cast of characters, I'm sorry to say, so the entire rogues gallery of Indian politics was there with him. Nobody was not present. Dushman, dost, sab the wahan pe. So, I was coming in to sit, I found that my seat was next to MG Akbar's. And we've been old friends and he's been my idol for a long time. I'm also sort of, you know, making a public claim that I'm much younger than him. But as I sat down, I said, MJ, what happens to people? And I will not mention the name. This is a well-known, very well-known editor. And I said, you know, I saw an article by him on my phone coming in saying that this is Sharad Pawar's announcement that he is the prime candidate for presidency next year. And by collecting everybody, he has shown that they are all with him, from Narendra Modi to Sonia Gandhi. So I said, look, it may happen next year, we don't know. But right now, on the evidence of an Indian politician turning 75, inviting his rivals and them turning up doesn't mean they'll support him for president. Second, BJP has a majority in Lok Sabha. Their numbers will increase in Rajya Sabha. They are winning more and more states. Why would they give the presidency to an outsider and take a chance with it? And least of all, somebody who they oppose in the state of Maharashtra. And least of all, somebody they've called all kinds of things. Maybe on the 75th birthday, they'll say nice things about him. But most of the other time, they're calling him a crook and a mafioso and all that stuff. So it's possible. In politics, anything is possible. But looks tough that this will happen. And MJ said to me, that's what happens when you migrate from print media to digital, because you lower the bar. And I said, at that point, we will do something on digital, but we'll never lower the bar. So that's how the name The Print came in, because print means seriousness. So that's the reason I'm here also. I'm grateful to people like all of you. All of us have learned our early journalism from printers. you know, in the days when we used to have hot metal presses, our foremen in the presses had the best news sense. Plus, they had a skill that none of us had. They could read a type inside out. Because type to ulti hoti thi na. So he'll read the type like this and he could read it inside out. I tried very hard to learn it. As a reporter, I had to learn the art of reading a document from the other end of the table. So this was a handy skill, but we could never do it like foreman. So you'll be around. I think 10 years from now, you should get a bigger hall to invite speakers like General Hasnain, because you will be able to fill it and there'll be a lot of printers. Of course, your business will keep changing. Now, you wanted me to talk about leadership, but I'm conscious that you wanted a break from your sort of serious deliberations of the day. Now, my experience of leadership, first of all, no leader comes with all the traits of leadership. If you see leaders around the country and around the world, and I will talk more about the ones that I've had the pleasure of misfortune of dealing with. They have one of the following five qualities, at least, or some of the following five qualities. And I'm not necessarily listing them in a hierarchical order. One is great intellect. Two, Narasimha Rao, Manmohan Singh, great intellect. Second, great instinct. Again, Narasimha Rao, Vajpayee. Third, great communication. Vajpayee, now Narendra Modi, without doubt the best communicator in our politics. The ability to build a great team. Indira Gandhi, look at the team she had around her in 71. From her defense secretary to the army chief to her home secretary to her foreign policy advisors. And great commitment to the job you are doing. Great commitment and great faith. I think a very good example is Narendra Modi again. Now, not any leader, any human being cannot have all these five qualities. Now, how do you make up for these? Some can have one of these qualities, some can have two, some can have three, the odd one may have four, but still, until you fill up for the fifth lacking quality, you cannot be a great leader. Now, let's look at some examples. See, globally, everybody is laughing at Trump, right? These are sort of Trump times. Even the morning when I came, I was watching Madonna making fun of Trump and wanting to bomb the White House, etc., etc., etc. But what is Trump? I mean, if you go right back to 1984, Trump is what Ronald Reagan was. Trump is a reality TV star. Ronald Reagan was a third-rate film star. Right? Or a Chavanya film star, as used to call in Bombay. People used to buy a ticket in Chavanya, sit in front, and every time the in a dacoit film, the one of the favorites danced, people would sort of bend to see if they could see more than what was revealed by the screen, right? So Reagan was a star from that kind of cinema. Nobody had attributed any intellect to him. In fact, a lot of the Americans then said to me, American liberals, I am in mourning. But the fact is, Reagan turned out to be a very good president. What is Trump? Trump is a Ronald Reagan of Twitter age, right? Can you imagine if Ronald Reagan had Twitter in his hands? What would he have done with it? He was much nuttier than Donald Trump. But what did Reagan do? Reagan collected a great team around himself. Reagan had one gift, one and a half gift. Reagan had great communication, and Reagan had a good instinct. Reagan had the instinct to know that this was the time to end the Cold War. He had the instinct to know that the Cold War will end not in Moscow, but in Afghanistan, starting with Kandahar. So he ended the Cold War there. He collected whatever he needed to win the Cold War in Afghanistan. He had similarly lost a war overseas for ideology in Vietnam. In Afghanistan, he played a different game, did not expose his own soldiers. in fact, got the Pakistanis, the Saudis, the Chinese, the Emiratis, everybody involved. And he just fought that war to the last Russian and the last Afghan. But he built a great team around himself, starting with his Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense. He laid the foundation, since General Saab is here, of the 600-ship Navy for America. He had the gentleman called Mr. Lehman, who was not a soldier, not a sailor. He wrote an article for Atlantic Quarterly on how America needs a 600-ship Navy. He hired him as his Secretary of the Navy, and that's the power that America used going ahead. So he knew his limitations, and he worked on them. You can see other examples. Since American presidents are much discussed, you can see a president with very good instinct, with very good intellect, like say Clinton, Rhodes Scholar, etc., etc. See the difference between Clinton 1 and Clinton 2. Clinton 1 was a disaster. Things went wrong all over the world under his watch because he had a bad team. Even in terms of his relationship with India, things were a disaster because he had the wrong choice for handling South Asia. His assistant secretary was a political appointee. He was a career diplomat, but political appointee. An old friend and classmate of his, a fellow Rhodes Scholar, I think, Robin Rafel. And we know what a disastrous relationship he had those 4 years. And then he got a better team, and relationship completely changed. Now, Clinton, great intellect, great communication. Even better than Obama, I would say. Great communication, very poor integrity, financial and otherwise, right? See, our founder, Ramnath Goenka, who all of you would remember, he used to say, ki mera editor jo marzi ho, hum jo marzi kare, par mera editor langot ka sacha hona chahiye. So Bill Clinton did not pass that test for a president. But the fact is, with his intellect, his instinct, his ability then to collect a better team in his second term, he ended up being a much better president than he could have been. And then you can go on and on. I don't think Bush had either. So he had a very bad time. In fact, he left the world in a big financial crisis. He had a bad team on his financial side. He just had his buddies from the corporate world, financial world run this. So that besides. Now come to India. I started knowing, until Rajiv Gandhi was Prime Minister, it was really below my station to interact with somebody at that level. I was too junior. All newspapers are also hierarchical. You don't get to do that stuff. So the stuff I got to do politically was either to cover elections, which is politics in a way, or to cover the opposition parties, right? Because all the losers are given to you. My first cover story for India Today was on the state of India's opposition in January of 1985, when Rajiv Gandhi had just got 413 seats and had declared that for the opposition, he now has a 10 plus 2 plus 3 formula. 10 Janata Party, 2 BJP, and 3 socialists. And that's when I went to do a story on India's opposition. And frankly, that's when I got to know Mr. Vajpayee well for the first time. Now, what was the difference then between, say, the state of the Congress party now? And that tells you, gives you a lesson in leadership. BJP was down to 2 seats in a house of 543. I was 27 years old, right? I called Mr. Advani's house. I called Mr. Vajpayee's house and a couple of other senior leaders, but these were the 2 main leaders at that time in the BJP. And I called and I said, I'm so-and-so from India Today magazine. I'm a reporter. Can I speak with them? So both of them called me back or came on the line. And Mr. Vajpayee said, Are, aap kya apna parichay de rahe hain? Aapko to hum mile the Assam mein, because I used to cover the Northeast before that. So he remembered it. I was 27. Both immediately gave me time. I went to see both of them. Both immediately opened up and shared a lot. They laughed at their own state. They talked about their plans, they talked about what they had done wrong, and they talked in 1985 January of the need to bring youth into the BJP. Because they said, ye Rajiv Gandhi jo election jeeta hai, ye jawani ke naam se bahut jeeta hai, to humko naujawan lane padenge. And in fact, I referred to that interview, and I think I quoted from it because it's a printed interview in India Today with Mr. Vajpayee, who said in January 85 that we need young leaders and we have some. Ye Delhi mein Arun Jaitley ko aap jante hi hain, ek Mumbai mein Pramod Mahajan bhi hai. So in 1985, this great leader was identifying young leaders of tomorrow instead of feeling threatened about them. So that brings us to the next, and in my book, the most important element for a good leader, which is a big heart. Without a big heart, nobody can be a big leader. You have to learn from generals. You know, I talk to anybody I meet. So I even meet, if I meet soldiers anywhere at an airport, railway station, I start chatting with them. And the answer I always get is, sahab, aap ye pahad ko jab chadhai karte hain, aur upar se jo defender fire karta hai, jaise Kargil mein hua. So don't you feel scared abhi kya hoga? Sahab, if our officer is in front, we don't worry at all. Because if he's risking his life, he has stakes in life, so do we trust him. We have faith. Now, why does the officer do it? The officer does it because officer has a big heart. Officer can stay back. Officer can say, main ye karunga, aap log jaake lado, mujhe kuch aur kaam karna hai, mujhe kuch general saab ka phone aaya hai, something, but doesn't happen like that. So only when a leader has a big heart do the troops follow. So Mr. Vajpayee, great example of a leader with great communication, great intellect, and a big heart. And I will tell you, how does a big heart work with sensitivity? I was reading last night, coming on the flight, Myra McDonald's latest book on Pakistan. It's a cruel title for the Pakistanis. The book's title is Defeat is an Orphan, right? And Myra is a very well established, very well reputed journalist on the subcontinent. So I was reading that book, and she was talking about the days of Op Parakram, when after Parliament attack, India piled up forces along the borders, and it looked like there'll be a war any moment. And she has a good analysis. She says that while this was done, frankly, Vajpayee never wanted to go to war. I mean, he wanted to use this, but Vajpayee was conscious of several things. One of which was the uncertainty of going into war and what will happen. Two, what were we going to achieve with the war? Third, that his army and public opinion, armed forces and public opinion really wanted the war, because they were very angry. And fourth, he was also conscious that while we had some superiority over Pakistan, it wasn't so decisive that we could bring a quick conclusion to that war, and we could get bogged down. And in a large country versus a small country, if a large country makes some gains and gets bogged down, it's a victory for the smaller country. Now, I say this is right because I'll tell you something from experience. When Parliament attack happened, within 10 days, build-up started, massive mobilization started from our side. It was one of those years, after a very long time, that we decided to take a vacation in Kerala, in the plantations. So I said, ye to phas gaye, hum chale jayenge, peeche se ladai ho jayegi shuru. So I asked Mr. Vajpayee for time, which he gave me. I went to see him. We sat in the garden of his house. This was December last week, I think a day after his birthday or before his birthday. In the sun, he drank his soup. He gave me some soup also, and I remember the soup was full of salt. And I thought, no human being, least of all somebody at that age, should be eating so much salt. But that besides, that's an aside. I said, aap yudh karne ja rahe hain ke nahin? To bole, aapko kya? हम करेंगे तो आप चलेंगे नहीं उसमें. सो ऐसे नहीं, हम तो चलेंगे, लेकिन आप सचमुच युद्ध करना चाहते हैं? डू यू रियली वॉन्ट टू गो टू वॉर? ही सेड, व्हाई यू सो बॉदर्ड, वील डू व्हाट नीड्स टू बी डन. ऑलवेज बैंटरिंग, ही वॉज नेवर समबडी टू एडमोनिश यू और एनीथिंग. सो आई सेड, लुक, आई विल टेल यू माई रियल कंसर्न. My concern is we have decided to go on a vacation to Kerala for a week. If you go to war while we are away, airspace will be closed and I'll be stuck there. What will I tell my grandchildren? Ki jab war ho gayi, ab Kerala mein jaake chup gaye, wo bhi plantations ke andar. I'll never be able to live that down. So he looked at me very sternly and he said, ye koi chutti jane ka samay hai? And my heart sank. I thought this guy is going to war. So then as usual, he paused. I let him pause because Arun Shori told me a long time back that when he pauses, once you ask him a question, that means he's outwaiting you. So you outwait him because he doesn't want to talk. So he pauses. So you also pause. Ultimately, he will answer you. Otherwise, he's waiting ki aap thak jaoge and you will move on to the next question. So by this time, I knew how to deal with him. So I also waited. So he said to me, bhai dekhiye, sab chahte hain ki yudh ho. Everybody wants to go to war. Yes. So he said at the CCS, Cabinet Committee of Security, I asked the generals, maine sena adhyakshon se pucha in Hindi, he said, I asked the three chiefs, bhai ye jab yudh hoga, ye sab chahte hain, yudh kare, peete jaake Pakistaniyon ko, thrash them, gusse mein bahut. To humne pucha, jab ye yudh ho jayega, और इसका इतिहास लिखा जाएगा, आई विल ट्रांसलेट इन इंग्लिश, बट इसका इतिहास लिखा जाएगा, तो उस पुस्तक जो लिखी जाएगी इसके इतिहास पर, उसका क्या नाम होगा? He said, when this war is over and the history of this war is written, what will this war be called? What will history call this war? So he said, they all asked me, what do you mean? So I said, see, 1971 was the war of liberation of Bangladesh. 1967, Israel, Arab world, is just called a six-day war because it was over in 6 days very decisively. 1973 was called Yom Kippur war because Egypt attacked on Yom Kippur day, taking advantage of that. So he said, what will this war be called? So he said, only the Navy chief got onto it. So Navy chief said, sir, I think what you mean is, what is the objective of this war? Navy chief was Admiral Sushil Kumar. He said, haan, humne yehi kaha. Humne kaha, what is the purpose of this war before you start? Is it to break up Pakistan? Is it to recover the rest of Kashmir? Is it to destroy Pakistani army? Is it to destroy Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed surgically? Is it to just fight a war because we are angry? So he said, there was no answer. So I said, will this be called? I said, will this be described by historians at the great war of Indian anger? You cannot go to war just because you are angry. You have to have objectives and you have to have the wherewithal to achieve those objectives. And he said, I told them that, and he said, jo maine unko bataya, wohi aapko bata raha hu. He said, and very sensitively and very thoughtfully he said this, he said, when you start a war, where you start a war, how you start a war is fully in your hands. Where the war will end, how the war will end, what will end the war is not in your hands. So it's a call you have to take very carefully. And I have to take those risks. I have the moral authority and moral responsibility to take that risk. And he said, that's when I explained to the chiefs also. And I said, you don't have to pass it down. Let everybody think there's going to be a war. And that's when he sort of, in his own way, explained the idea of coercive diplomacy. That you're using armed forces to achieve certain objectives. And if I read Myra McDonald's book, while many of the others said, that this was a wasted buildup, etc., etc., etc. The fact is, if you read Myra's book, between January 2002, when the buildup really started, to October 2002, remember what was achieved. He had been able to hold a fresh election in Kashmir without any interference in Pakistan, restore the political process, and kill the Kashmiri insurgency. They were 4,500 people killed in Kashmir in 2001, There were 3,500 killed in 2002. There were not even 500 killed in 2003. And from then on, we came to such a peaceful situation that until 2012 was the most peaceful year. There were just 14 soldiers in various uniforms, which included 7 Kashmir police employees, killed in all of Kashmir. So he achieved peace. He killed the Kashmiri insurgency. How did he do it? He did it with this great leadership quality, where he took the risk. He took also the risk of piling up his forces. In fact, I asked him, I said, ye kabhi bhi ho jayega, ab kab tak rok payenge isko? Kabhi ko jhagda. And it, something like that happened later. There was a Kaluchak attack, where the terrorists came and attacked the families of our soldiers. 31 of them were killed. It was a very touch and go situation. So in fact, Brajesh Mishra explained to him, to me on his behalf, he said, bhai, ye coercive diplomacy, for it to be successful, the threat has to be so real that even we believe it. Now, so what do you see here? You see in Vajpayee great instinct. You see in Vajpayee great commitment. I would say great intellect, because you have to have intellect to say that you, starting a war is in your hands. Finishing it and how this will finish is not in your hands. Great team. He built Brajesh Mishra, Jaswant Singh, Yashwant Sinha, Arun Shori, Pramod Mahajan. He built a very talented team. Frankly, and I say this because I'm a journalist, I say nothing off the record. I think his team was enormously more talented than what we have today under Mr. Modi. There's no comparison. It's like, I mean, his team versus Mr. Modi's team is like, it's like today's India playing today's Zimbabwe, right? With Tendulkar in it. So that's what today's cabinet is, Mr. Modi, the Tendulkar, and the rest is Zimbabwe, whose names also you don't need to remember. But Mr. Vajpayee, on the other hand, had built a great cabinet, and see the results he had. Now, my only regret is, and then we can talk about others, I think many will come in the question session, I want to keep to my time. See, Mr. Vajpayee, Mr. Narasimha Rao, Dr. Manmohan Singh, I think they have been three of our greatest leaders so far. Dr. Narasimha Rao, great instinct, great intellect, zero communication, very poor integrity, right? But a very clever mind. You know, he's the cleverest mind I have dealt with as a, you know, at the other end of the fence, as a leader. Wo koi baat seedhi bolte nahi the. In fact, he always reminded me of something that Ramnath Goenka used to tell us about his own mind. He used to say, my mind is so complicated that if you hammer a nail from this end, it will come out as a screw. Kehte yahan se keel thoko ki yahan se page ban ke niklegi. So Narasimha Rao had a mind like that. Great patriot, but again, no integrity, no communication. So he achieved something. Manmohan Singh, great intellect, great integrity, communication even poorer than Narasimha Rao's, right? And very unsure of himself. You know, for somebody who once said to me that, who said to Musharraf and told me that, he said to Musharraf, in their first meeting, that you and I are both accidental leaders of our countries, but remember, public office is like public trust. You can't have it and do nothing with it. So now that we have public office, we must do something with it. So a man like him, my complaint with him is that he put his feudal loyalties to the first family of his party above the trust of his office, particularly in his second term. If he had resigned, or threatened to resign the day his party went back on the Sharm el-Sheikh agreement in 2009, just after it won his election, he would have had a much better second term, and frankly, Congress party would have still lost, but would not have had 44 seats in parliament. So the common thing between these three, Vajpayee, Narasimha Rao, and Manmohan Singh, and I think each one would have achieved a lot more given the combination of qualities they had. The common problem between them was that each one became prime minister 10 years too late in their lives. Because of the mid-70s, late-70s, you know, we love old age in our country, right? once Madhara Sindhya told me that anytime he asks his party for more responsibility, they tell him, Aba bhi naujawan hai. So he said to me then that I'm 53 years old. I'm a grandfather twice over. What else do they want? So I said, Abhi, aap 75 se pehle India mein nobody takes you seriously. But the fact is, and it's something that Dr. Singh once said to us. He said, you know, when we asked him in his first term, within 6 months, that what's been your biggest realization in this job? He said, my biggest realization is this is a job for a much younger person. I think if any of these three great leaders, if they had got the job 10 years earlier, we would have seen very different results in our country. We have an interesting situation now. We have a leader who's got some of these qualities, who's got great communication, the best communicator in India's history, who's got great instinct, who's got great personal integrity. He only has to show, I don't know about intellect, but leaders don't need to have intellect. If they have the fourth quality, which is the ability to collect a great team around themselves. So if you see the weaknesses of Modi government, it is that it perhaps, and I say this carefully, it perhaps has the poorest team of any prime minister I have seen in the country since I have kept track of Indian politics since 1977, I became a journalist. So I wasn't covering politics directly, but I was watching and I've read a lot. I think this is the poorest team. And this is, frankly, it's not because talent is not available in the country. I think he has shown a certain lack of openness to ideas, to other people. There's a certain belief that I have all the answers. Right, and it's once you are a powerful leader and you believe all the answers, and everybody tells you, yes, sir, you have all the answers, right? Yahan to sare poonch lagne lagte hain samne khade hoke. Very few will tell you no. I mean, if he had people around him who could tell him anything other than what he believes, they would have told him not to wear that suit, right? It's done him damage because anybody would have done it. Any staff member would have said, this is not appropriate, don't do it. But obviously, either nobody had the intellect to do it or nobody had the courage to do it. So he has a poor team. His cabinet is poor. It's a one-man government. I think this will be tested. This idea will be tested going ahead. As I said, you can have any of the other five great qualities of a leader. But unless you have a big heart, you cannot be remembered as a great leader. And remember, a big heart means ability to accept other talent, ability to believe that other people know better than me, and then complete lack of insecurity in collecting them around you. You know, I've been around in journalism for a long time. A lot of people have worked with me. A lot of people have left me. A lot of people have worked 30 years with me and stayed on. Many left earlier. But I'm so happy when I see all of them doing so well. My trainees have become editors, as general sahabs, subalterns have become generals now. And when people ask me, "Arey, tum, aapko bura nahi lagta ki aapke liye kaam kiya, chhod ke chale gaye?" So I tell them, I am like Ajit in an old Hindi movie. Hamare aadmi charon taraf phele hue hain, right? So you can always reach out to them. So I think the basic thing is, and I'm speaking from experience of dealing with great leaders. The great leaders have some or a lot, or at least one of these key qualities. On top of that, if they have a big heart, Ronald Reagan, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Indira Gandhi, Obama, then they are remembered by history. All the others, then in the course of time, are forgotten. Yeah. Narasimha Rao will be forgotten, right? Frankly, Rajiv Gandhi has been forgotten. It doesn't matter how many bridges are named after him, right? In fact, if I had my way, I would, if I was even running a Congress government, I would rename this bridge, this flyover, what you call, ceiling, I would rename it after YB Chauhan. I think YB Chauhan was among the two greatest defense ministers in India's history, YB Chauhan and Jagjivan Ram. And he was from Maharashtra, he was a Marathi leader. Everybody's wooing the Marathas now. I would rename it after YB Chauhan. So no matter how much you name after Rajiv Gandhi, but Rajiv Gandhi will be forgotten. Indira will not be forgotten. Frankly, Manmohan Singh will not be forgotten for what he did in 91. So I think that's the basic thing. I will conclude here.
Shekhar ji, Modi ka heart bada to ho gaya kyunki 56 inch ka seena hai, to heart andar bada hi hona chahiye. Gentlemen, we have about time for two questions. So can I just please see a show of hands? Two questions, please. Yes, sir. General sir, please. Of course, sir. You're most welcome.
Microphone.
Mic,
please.
He's getting it.
I want a loud enough voice.
Oh, lovely.
This is our pleasure.
Shekhar sahab, what a pleasure to hear you. 40 minutes, absolutely spellbound. Two observations I will give you on the aspects of leadership. I thought Narasimha Rao's greatest moments, 1994 passing the joint resolution in parliament on Kashmir, was probably the most amazing thing, getting all parties together. And the second was sending Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Salman Khurshid to the Human Rights Summit in Geneva, where they won the hearts of the world. And this was the best moment for political India. And that is, I think, some example. This is one example which needs to be quoted always about Narasimha Rao. Now, having said that, I think Vajpayee, his greatest thing was he changed Musharraf's heart. Musharraf offered the ceasefire because he thought ultimately that history will forget Musharraf but will always remember Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And it's because of that that you found a changed Musharraf after 2003. Your comments on this.
Sir, I will tell you something about both these. First of all, the way Narasimha Rao dealt with Kashmir, this was a very tough time for him. You know, how many of you have seen the film Haider? Yes. On Kashmir. If you've seen the film Haider, that was set in Narasimha Rao's times. So nobody gives Narasimha Rao credit for it because he never sought it. He was a very devious fellow. He did all the dirty things without letting anybody know. But the most brutal fight backs by the Indian state against separatist violence in Kashmir and in Punjab was carried out under Narasimha Rao's watch. That was the period, 91 to 94, when Kashmiri insurgency was put down, when Ikhwanis and others were raised, and when Khalistani insurgency was put down in Punjab. It was that Narasimha Rao's period. But I do remember once, Benazir Bhutto made a statement and she became prime minister. She said, oh, somebody asked her, so are you talking to an Indian counterpart? She said, I don't know who to talk to. You know how Benazir was. She was an idiot. She said, you know, when they had people of some class, you could talk to them. Meaning thereby that when Rajiv was there, they were our level ke log the. Now who to talk? Narasimha Rao found it very hurtful. So in fact, he once said to me, I will make a horrible example of her. So from that day on, this was a single-minded thing with him. And that parliament resolution was ultimately a result of that. Because his thing was, how dare a prime minister of Pakistan not take the prime minister of India seriously? And of course, he had his own complexes vis-a-vis the Gandhis also. Second, you mentioned, what was it? Atal Bihari Vajpayee, yes. That was, you know, Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Rao had a very good equation. They were old-fashioned politicians. In fact, there's a famous exchange where Narasimha Rao said, ye toh mere guru hain, and Vajpayee said, agar hum guru hain, toh ye hain guru ghantal. Right? They were great friends. And see, now if you go back to that Human Rights Commission hearing in Geneva, that was a time when India was under great pressure from human rights organizations around the world, particularly Human Rights Watch, etc., Amnesty International. And we had made some mistakes before that. Jagmohan, in his eternal lack of wisdom, I'm not a Jagmohan fan, he drove out all foreign media from Kashmir. Besides the fact that under his watch, all the pundits were driven out, he drove out all the foreign media also. So as all foreign media was driven out and barred from going to Kashmir, all kinds of rumors spread about Kashmir. And people start believing the worst. Mass rapes, mass killings, mass this, mass that. And that had led to a big problem globally. And that's when Pakistan and others moved this resolution in Geneva at the Human Rights Convention. So it was important for Narasimha Rao, one, to send his best communicator. Second, to ensure that he showed the world a united face for India. And third, for the public opinion in India, he knew that he wasn't a particularly popular prime minister. So he had to send somebody who was personally very popular in India and had great credibility. So that's Vajpayee. And fourth, imagine Vajpayee's deputy was Salman Khurshid, then Minister of State for Foreign Affairs. So a leader of a Hindu party, a Muslim leader of a Congress party, acting as his deputy, working together, and they won. There's always honor among thieves. So the Chinese and the Iranians voted for us. Their human rights record is, if anything, much worse than ours. And we succeeded there. I did a cover story on this when they came back. In fact, it was a picture that we had Vajpayee and Salman Khurshid pose when they hugged each other. And sir, you remember after that, that's completely unspeakable character, Munir Akram, the Pakistan's ambassador to the UN, he called Salman Khurshid a rented Muslim, right? Because they just could not handle it. That, you know, Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Salman Khurshid going and fighting for India. Second for Vajpayee, sir, and I know time's up. Vajpayee's mind. I went to see him when he called Musharraf. Because there was a little background before that also that, you know, the only time I've done anything non-journalistic in my life was towards a good end, which was setting up the bus ride to Lahore. It was a conspiracy between Nawaz Sharif, Vajpayee and me. We did a 1-2. So I'd gone to see him and he would often reach out to me. So I'd gone to see him and I said, aapne achanak isko kaise bula liya? Musharraf ko. So, he's a poet, very sensitive man. He said, ye, main kya bataun? Ek Saxena ji hain humare, Lucknow mein mitra hain. His constituency was Lucknow. Unka ladka tha, major tha. Aur wo, shaheed ho gaya. Kashmir mein, to khabar aayi ki uski mrityu ho gayi hai. To humne kaha, hum ek bar phone karte hain, humare constituency ke, hum jante hain Saxena ji ko, unke pitaji ko humne phone kiya. तो उनका हमने फोन किया उन्होंने कहा अरे इसमें क्या बड़ी बात है एक ही बच्चा तो गया है मेरे तो चार बच्चे होते चारों जाते देश के लिए कोई बात नहीं है तो इधर हमने बहुत सोचा हमने कहा इतने बहादुर मां-बाप हैं दे आर सो काम अबाउट द सैक्रिफाइस आई एम जस्ट ट्रांसलेटिंग इन इंग्लिश बिकॉज़ देयर आर मेनी पीपल हु डोंट अंडरस्टैंड हिंदी ही सेड बट राइट नाउ दिस इज द एड्रेनलिन फ्लो मार्टर्डम अ वीक लेटर When he sees the widowed wife, widowed daughter-in-law, he sees young children, he misses his son, he'll feel the vacuum. And then I thought, in 50 years, how many families have been made to feel the same vacuum in India and Pakistan? And must it go on happening for the next 50 years? So somebody has to take the risk and try and break this vicious cycle. I'm translating in English, which doesn't sound so good, because his Hindi was so brilliant. So he said, that's when I decided that. But I heard this from the other end, from Mr. Vajpayee. I said, kya hua? Arre saab, vahiyat aadmi hai. Wo jeb mein kagaz leke aaya. Aur bola, ye aap bhi sign kariye, hum bhi kariye, ab ho gaya. Hum nahi kare, hum kaise kare? Hamari cabinet hai, hamari CCS hai. Arre, aap prime minister hai, main president hu. Arre, kaise samjhaye? Akal hi nahi hai. Right? So they started from there. But then they became, you know, they leveled with each other. And I think it was the greatness of Vajpayee's heart which changed things. And frankly, Vajpayee gave us 10, 12 years of peace, even today relative peace compared to what it was in up to 2002. So since you raised the two points, I gave slightly involved answers.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So the hallmark of a great leader is that you ask one question and it turns out to be two. Ladies and gentlemen, can I please request Mr. Mehul Desai to please felicitate Shekhar ji? Put your hands together, please.